maybe they knew you were going to say something and they got afraid. I don't know.
Do you have someone to lead in the pledge?
Yes, we do. If we can have the scouts.
Okay, all the scouts.
All the scouts. Come down to the front. That would be great. And including their troop leaders, if you could all come down as well.
And then I was looking for Pastor Harris from our First United Methodist Church. Well, Pastor David, good. See, I was looking. Thank you. We will get started in just a moment. We'll make this official before you get started, Councilmember Cook. We call the meeting to order of our August 27th, 2015 Gilbert Town Council meeting. Welcome, I am Mayor John Lewis. Councilmember Cook will introduce the scouts, and we will have one of the scouts lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance, please.
Well, Mayor, thank you very much. First of all, let's have a round of applause for these wonderful young men that want to make America and our city a little better. Thank you. Yeah, that's great. And I'll pass the mic down later so everyone can introduce himself. We have a young man named Garrett that will lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance. So if we can all rise and have more of our scouts come in.
I pledge of allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Well, thank you, Garrett. As a thank you from the council, I have here a copy of the United States Constitution that they can have and read and study, and I know that we'll test them when they come back next time on a little quiz. But with that, if we can have you introduce yourself, your name, and your troop number, and then pass the mic down.
Hi. Gavin. My name is Gavin, and I'm in Troop 6756, or Super Troop.
I'm Sam Kirk, and I'm in Troop 756.
I'm Kyle Johnson. I'm from Troop 756 in the Super Troop.
I'm Mason Parker, and I'm from Troop 756 in the Super Troop.
I'm Xavier Horvath, and I'm the same, 756, and in the Super Troop.
I'm Clayton Weberg, and I'm from Troop 322.
Darren Smith, Troop 756.
David Servistini, Troop 776, Super Troop Scoutmaster.
Joseph Campbell, I'm the Scoutmaster for Troop 776.
My name is Brigham Norton, and I'm in Troop 776.
I'm Preston Wilkinson, and I'm in Troop 776.
I'm Sam Ayers in Troop 776.
I'm Tanner Waldron, and I'm in Troop 776.
I'm Matthew Jensen, and I'm from Troop 322.
I'm Jill Fowler. I'm from Troop 322.
I'm Jeremiah Fowler. I'm from Troop 322.
I'm Andrew McIntyre. I'm from Troop 322.
I'm Charlie Wells, and I'm from Troop 322.
I'm Jaden Wigley from Troop 322.
I'm Weston Benson Sorensen, and I'm from Troop 322.
I'm Garrett Barnes, and I'm from Troop 322.
Chris Jensen, Troop 322.
Private Sasek from the Chandler Mustangs.
Hi, I'm Rick Schimmel. I'm the unit commander for the Chandler Mustangs. And this is one of the young Marines that I get to mentor, and it is an awesome program, youngmarines.com.
Well, thank you so very much. Can we have a round of applause again for these wonderful men? And thank you for coming.
It's great to have Mustang here, and the troop numbers many, but the 776. That almost sounds like a Declaration of Independence troop, but coming up in September, in just a few weeks, we invite all the community. I'm just inserting this before we have our invocation. The Constitution that all the scouts received And from our Mustang group was September of 1787, and we celebrate that in Gilbert. And please pay attention to when all the celebrations will be taking place specifically. And Councilmember Peterson, I know that at the end of the meeting we're going to say this, but on September 17th, Thursday night, please.
We'll be having a wonderful event at Mission Community Church called One Nation Under God, and the community is invited. It's a free event, and it's going to be an inspirational event, uniting all people of all faith under the banner of religious freedom. So we're excited about that, Mayor.
And 2 days later, on September 19th, Saturday night, from 6 to 9 p.m. right here on the grass here at Town Hall, will be the Constitution Fair, and it will end with fireworks at about 9 o'clock. Now, with that, we invite Pastor David Harris to come to the podium. First United Methodist Church had a wonderful celebration just a week or so ago, 100 years in Gilbert. We appreciate their service, and it's a pleasure to have Pastor David Harris with us tonight to give the invocation, please.
Thank you, Mayor Lewis, council members. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, we thank you for this beautiful day that you've given us. We thank you for the rain which we feel. We thank you for the way in which you allow us to know that you are still with us. We ask, Lord, that as we come to this place, that we would be united as one under your umbrella. We ask, O Lord, that as we make critical decisions which are valid and useful in the life of Gilbert, Arizona, that you would be with us this evening. We ask that all the decisions which would be made here would be acceptable in your sight. And we ask that the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts and all decisions which are made in this place would be according to your gracious will. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. The roll call will now be conducted, please. Lisa.
Mayor John Lewis.
Here.
Vice Mayor Jordan Ray.
Here.
Councilmember Eddie Cook.
Here.
Councilmember Jen Daniels.
Here.
Councilmember Victor Peterson.
Here.
Councilmember Bridget Peterson. Councilmember Jared Taylor.
Here.
A quorum is present.
Thank you. We will proceed with our presentations and proclamations. For the team members on number two, we're going to move you to the end, and we'll do one, and then three through seven, and then we'll do two. Councilmember Peterson.
About that, could I invite the budget team for the town of Gilbert up to the front here for a minute? It really is my pleasure tonight to present this award to you. And before I go into the details about that, we usually like to let people have a chance to say something if they'd like. If not, that's okay, but we want to, you know, recognize you guys tonight and your excellent work. So
just how proud we are of the budget team. I'm new to the team, and they've done a great job, and we'll keep carrying on the tradition.
So this team knows me well. For those who are new on the team, they will get to know me well. And this item is perfect for me because I'm what you call a budget connoisseur. I don't know if that's a proper term, but that's definitely how I feel about budgets. And so tonight what we want to do is recognize the town of Gilbert for the Distinguished Budget Presentation Award. Now, this is a beautiful award, but it is more than just this object here. The budget really is a fantastic document here in the town of Gilbert. I've looked at budgets really actually all over the country, and the transparency that we offer, the opportunity for citizens to know what's going on, how their money is spent, is way above the norm. And so I'm very proud of that, and I would love to give you guys a huge round of applause. Ceremonial stuff is not quite my thing. I will just mention, we don't have anyone here tonight to receive the proclamation, but just to acknowledge, Mayor Lewis has proclaimed September 2015 as Grand Family Kinship Care Month. We encourage you to learn more about that. It's a great initiative. Thank you, Mayor.
For this next item, I'd like to invite Dr. Jim Williams and Sasha Garola forward. Thank you for being with us. It's a pleasure here to share this proclamation on the topic of American Cancer Fund for Children and Kids Cancer Connection. Tell us a little bit about your role and why we're here tonight.
My name is Sasha. I'm the clinical coordinator for the Phoenix Children's Hospital Center for Cancer and Blood Disorders in the East Valley. It's nice that we are able to care for the kids in the East Valley. And I'll quickly defer to Dr.
Hi, I'm Jim Williams. I'm a pediatric oncologist for the East Valley. And if it's okay, I'll say a few words. I'll keep it short. I want to thank you all, of course. I wanted to say that in my lifetime, I've seen cancers go, and childhood cancers go from incurable to 80 to 90% curable in our leukemia group, which is great, a huge advancement. But despite that advancement, childhood cancer remains the number one cause of death due to disease in kids. So it's a very important thing. It's devastating to families. They have to face financial problems, emotional, social, physical problems, and challenges that most people would never even dream about. And for that reason, we applaud the Mayor Lewis and the City Council's support of families whose lives are forever changed by cancer.
Well, thank you.
And I'm from Troop 301 as Assistant Scoutmaster and a motorcyclist, so I support the,
I think he's covered everything, Mayor. How's that? Well, under Mayor Lewis's leadership, the Town Council is pleased to declare September 2015 as Awareness Month, Childhood Cancer Awareness Month. So if we could join here in a big round of applause for all the great work that they do.
Is Amanda Dean here? As Amanda's coming up, let me tell you about this fifth proclamation that we're doing tonight. This is to make people aware of Child Support Awareness Month. And I'm just going to read one brief part of this, and then I'll pass the mic to you, and you can tell us a little bit about what you do. It says, with the focus on a changing culture, the Arizona Department of Economic Security Division of Child Support Services is committed to engaging with parents and families through improved accessibility, providing personal development and employment opportunities to assist Arizonans to reach their full potential, humbly serving Arizonans with excellence, respect, integrity, and kindness, and being a champion for economic growth and opportunity. So on behalf of Mayor Lewis, we do declare August as Child Support Awareness Month in Gilbert, Arizona.
And I honestly don't think I could say it any better than that, except for I'll share with you that over the past fiscal year, we've collected over $349 million to serve our families. That's significant. And thank you, and I appreciate all your partnerships. Thank you, Mayor.
All right, item number six, we want to invite up Lieutenant Joe Kasich along with Chief Dorn and the rest of those of you who are involved in this item. Come on up, please. We'll turn the microphone over to Lieutenant Kasich to explain what happened here.
You have the two citizens come up? Then and
Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Joe Kasich. I'm a lieutenant with the police department. Happy to be here to make this presentation. It's fairly common for police officers to get service awards because obviously we have a dangerous job and willingly place ourselves in that position. But we're here tonight to present an award to some citizens who stepped into that role and certainly had no responsibility to do that. Chief Dorn is going to present certificates. I have a prepared thing I'm going to read. It's a little bit long, so please be patient if you would. On March 1st, 2015, just after midnight, Officer Chris Robinson conducted a traffic stop on a vehicle near Greenfield and Baseline Roads. Based on the driving behavior, Officer Robinson thought the driver might have been impaired. After contacting the driver, it was apparent there were significant signs and symptoms of alcohol impairment. Upon attempting to arrest the driver turned and punched Officer Robinson in the side of the head. Officer Robinson engaged the suspect in a physical confrontation, attempting to gain control of him to effect the arrest. Despite several attempts to gain compliance from the suspect continued to fight with Officer Robinson. At some point during the physical struggle, both individuals went to the ground with the driver continuing to try and punch and grab Officer Robinson's hands. Officer Robinson continued to fight with the suspect until he rolled over, grabbed Officer Robinson's wrists and sunk his teeth into Officer Robinson's right forearm. This dangerous confrontation turned even more dangerous as Officer Robinson continued to strike the suspect several times, trying in vain to get the suspect to release his bite. Only after applying his thumb to the suspect's eye socket did the suspect release the bite on Officer Robinson's arm. At that time, Officer Robinson attempted to stand, but because of the long duration of the continuous fighting, he fell back to the ground in exhaustion. The suspect, also quite exhausted, was barely able to stand, and Officer Robinson tasered him while Officer Robinson was lying on his side on the ground. Although the suspect was temporarily incapacitated, Officer Robinson was still unable to effect an arrest. Just then, citizens Ben Schneider and Jonathan Kyle Cagle ran up to Officer Robinson to assist him. Ben and Kyle were in a passing vehicle when they witnessed the assault on Officer Robinson and observed the seriousness of the confrontation. Without hesitation or due regard for their own safety, Ben and Kyle kept the suspect down after the taser had stopped. Officer Robinson threw his handcuffs to them as they assisted in arresting and handcuffing the suspect. Thanks to the heroic actions of these two citizens, a dangerous suspect was arrested and an officer was able to go home and see his family at the end of that shift. For this reason, the Gilbert Police Department would like to present Ben Schneider and Jonathan Kyle Cagle with the Valorous Conduct Award in honor of their courageous actions and service to the citizens of Gilbert and the police department. We also have Officer Robinson's wife, Jenny Robinson, here, who wanted to say a few words as well.
As a wife of a police officer, it hurts my heart to hear citizens criticize the police force and the things that they do, sometimes second-guessing their choices after they've been trained and they know what they're doing and they know their job. And it restores faith in my heart to know that instead of criticizing, you were there to support him and to help him. And so I wanted to say thank you from my family, from all of us. Thank you so much.
So to all of our police officers, all of our firefighters, and to Ben and to Kyle, we say thank you for what you guys do. We don't become the second safest city in America without police officers who work so hard, without residents and citizens who are willing to do things like this. So one more time, let's give them a round of applause.
Thank you. We have on this left wall our character counts, pillars of character, and I think Ben and Jonathan are two fine examples of that. But the pillar of the month, Councilmember Cook, if you can read that, please.
This month's highlighted pillar is responsibility. As a council members and town staff, we are dedicated to being reliable and fulfilling all obligations. We accept responsibility for our decisions, not making excuses. We are committed to being accountable for the services we provide.
Thank you. We will shift back to agenda item number two, special presentation on our Gilbert census. Some of you in the community have heard that we have been looking for individuals to help as far as a special job for a few months. We're going to get an update on that and then find out a little bit more about what's going to be happening in our Gilbert community over the next few months. Justine, please.
Good evening, Mayor Lewis, members of the council. Mayor Lewis is exactly right. Gilbert is hosting a one-day job fair, so to speak. It is for special census jobs. It will be at Southeast Regional Library from 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. We encourage everyone to show up, fill out an application, take the test, and hopefully you will qualify to be a census worker to undertake Gilbert's special census. The hourly pay is $16.25 an hour, including mileage. In addition to that, so we encourage everyone to apply, and we look forward to hopefully having you join Gilbert's special census. Okay. Moving on, Gilbert is now going to give you a quick update on where we are in regards to our outreach and awareness campaign. So starting on Monday, August 31st, we are launching that piece of the special census. Part of that piece is driving home, you know, why the special census is so important to us, what it means for our residents, and what they can expect. We will also be reiterating at that time to open your door, take the survey, be counted, really imparting to residents their ability to bring millions of their own tax dollars back into the community. Part of the outreach and awareness campaign was to undertake a PSA. Many of the council members and some staff assisted in creating this PSA. You are all wonderful actors. I don't know if your Academy Award is coming just yet, but we appreciate your participation. The PSA will air on our website, Channel 11, and if you happen to be visiting Santan in Harkins Theater, you can catch it from the month of October to about mid-November. So we want to thank everyone that participated, and please enjoy.
Workers come and knock on your door, open it. Bring your tax dollars home. Be counted. Learn more at GilbertCensus.com.
Are you sad that this video is over? Subscribe to our YouTube channel and you will never be sad again. Ever.
The things you'll do for your community.
That's right. So we don't want anyone sad. And over the next few months, we'll be anxious to have everyone in Gilbert counted. So thank you. Before we proceed, what will happen next will be our communication from citizens. And we do have one request, and then we will get to our consent calendar. There's one particular item where there are a number of people that are wishing to speak. And I'm just going to talk out loud with Vice Mayor Ray for a moment so we can prepare for that in case they needed, some of the citizens needed to group together. We have one citizen that, and this is agenda item 13, is neither for or against, and that will be Joan Kruger. And she'll be able to come forward, and is it 3 minutes that she'll be given?
Yes, Mayor.
Okay. And then we had a total of seven that fit in a category that wish to speak in favor.
We do. But the one question we have, Mayor, is we have another six people who are in favor of 13 but did not select whether they okay. wanted to speak or not.
Why don't you go ahead and announce the names, and we'll find out if they wanted to speak.
So Michael and Angela Amick, were you wanting to speak or just show your support for that item? Show support. Thank you. Leslie Miner. Thank you. Elizabeth Havlicek. Chris LaBelle. And the last one, I apologize in advance, to Koya Kalikse. Support. Thank you. So, Mayor, we have seven people who want to speak in okay. favor of it.
When we have multiple speakers, sometimes we'll give a set amount of time, and then as a group, and this is why I'm announcing it now, as a group, if you want someone to speak longer, you can. And so a group of, based on the time that's usually allotted, we'd probably say 10 minutes for the seven. Vice Mayor Ray, does that sound right?
That sounds correct, Mayor.
All right, so we'll move on, and then as a group, if you have some that you wish to speak longer, they could speak longer, and then estimated time would be for about 10 minutes for the seven.
Mayor, would it be helpful if I just read their names real quick?
Sure, please.
Who they were. These are people who have wished to speak in favor of item 13. Kevin Dang, David Milton, Lou Payne, Skip Erickson, Barbara Warren, Jackie Kalikste, Jack, and Crystal Reedy. So if the seven of you will maybe huddle together and determine how long you want to speak for, but a total of 10 minutes, Mayor, for... You can split that time however you think is best.
And huddling could be right outside the doors, or it could be over by that wall. And Joe in the orange shirt has a good huddling spot if you wanted to get together there. All right, so we will proceed. Vice Mayor Ray, the next item on the agenda is communication from citizens, please.
We invite Joe Gusick to the microphone. Joe, as you've heard before, if you would state your name and whether you're a Gilbert resident, please, and we'll give you 3 minutes.
Perfect. My name is Joe Gusick, and I am a Gilbert resident. Mayor Lewis, fellow town council members, Gilbert employees, residents, and guests of our community. Mayor Lewis, you couldn't have set this up any better than tonight. The word responsibility, and then a PSA. I love it. I want to share with you my favorite four-letter word, and nobody ever has to fear about this word. It is vote. So just yesterday, 95 years ago, Secretary of State Bain Bridget Colby certified the ratification of the 19th Amendment. 8 days prior to that, the Tennessee legislation was the 36th state to ratify the amendment, and it passed the legislation by one vote. Harry Byrne, a young legislator, changed his vote to yes after receiving a letter from his mother telling him to do the right thing. As I'll read several quotes to you, tell me and I forget, teach me and I remember, involve me and I learn, Ben Franklin. It is perhaps a sign of strength of a republic that so few people feel the need to participate. That must be the reason, John Stewart, America. The Citizen's Guide to a Democracy in Action. The future of this republic is in the hands of the American voter, Dwight D. Eisenhower. Elections belong to the people and their decisions. If they decide to turn their back on the fire and burn their behinds, then they will just have to sit on their blisters, Abraham Lincoln. American youth attributes more importance to arriving to a driver's license than voting age. Voter apathy was and will remain the greatest threat to our democracy. As all of you have taken an oath to protect our country from foreign and domestic, I think one of those things that we might have as a bigger threat to just an individual would be apathy. So as I will each and every single year, when this time comes around, I will encourage the town, the county, the state, and the federal government to encourage people to register to vote and to actually encourage them to vote as well. As you did so well on that PSA, I look forward to Mayor Lewis before he steps down, that he does a PSA encouraging everybody in the town of Gilbert to register and vote. Thank you.
Thank you. And am I supposed to fall off on a bike on that too? No. Whatever it takes, right? Thank you. Vice Mayor Ray, any other request on communication from citizens?
Mayor, that is the only communication from citizens.
Thank you. We will move to the consent calendar. And council member feedback, please.
So, Mayor, we do have a gentleman who wanted to speak on item 17 within the consent calendar. That agenda item is being continued until September 10th. So I don't know if Mr. Smith would still like to say a few words or if he would rather wait until the September 10th meeting when that item is discussed. This is James Smith who signed. Going once.
Maybe he saw that.
Yeah, he may have left, Mayor.
Okay, all right, thank you.
So for the rest of the consent items, we are going to pull items 9 and 13, Mayor.
Okay.
Keeping in mind that item 12 has been removed. With that, Mayor, I motion that we approve items 8, 10, 11, 14, 15A through E, 16, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25A through D, 26, 27, 29, 30, 31, 32, and I'll look to Councilmember Taylor on item 42.
Thank you, Vice Mayor. I move to appoint to the Parks and Recreation Library Services Advisory Board Lon Schaefer as a regular member to fill the remainder of the term ending May 12, 2017, and Matthew Roberts as a regular member to fill the remainder of the term ending May 12, 2016, plus an additional term beginning May 13, 2016, and ending May 12, 2019.
Second.
With that motion and second, please vote. Those are approved with a 6-0 vote. Thank you.
Mayor, there are two additional items. On item 17 to the legal counsel, do we need to make a motion to continue that? That was asked to be continued prior to the meeting.
Mayor, members of the council, that's correct. It does.
And so before I make that motion, I'll also just add item 28 we skipped. That's because it's going to the public hearing. So anyone who's thinking of that item. So with the counsel from our attorney, I also move that we continue item 17 until the September 10th, 2015 meeting.
Second.
With that motion, second, please vote on that item. That is also approved with a 6-0 vote. Thank you. We move then to agenda item number 9. Which council member wishes to speak on that?
That was Councilmember Victor Peterson, Mayor.
Please.
Mayor, no real discussion on this. I've made my concerns known about this before, and I know we have a busy agenda, so just wanted to pull it so I could vote separately. Thanks, Mayor.
Thank you. Any other comments on 9? All right, I will entertain a motion.
Mayor, I motion that we approve item number 9, please.
Second.
Okay, with that motion, second, please vote. That's approved with a 4-2 vote. Thank you. And agenda item number 13, this is the item we have various individuals wishing to speak, and I think for the public, there was a short summary of agenda item 13 that was prepared by staff, and we will proceed with that presentation.
Mayor Lewis, real quick, while we have a second and Justine's pulling that up, I wondered if we could tell the public real quickly why it's so important that they answer on the first call or the first door knock when the census comes. And really, It's a matter of finances. The longer the census is drawn out, the more expensive it is. So we are encouraging people to make sure that they respond as soon as they get that card, because we are not allowed to track as those cards come in. We have to wait to a date certain in order to measure how well we've done in collecting the data. And we want this to go as quickly as possible with the best response possible. So there is an incentive, a financial incentive for us as a community to make sure that we answer that first door knock or answer that first postcard.
Thank you. We have a room full of advocates ready to help with that census and answer the door.
All right. Good evening, Mayor Lewis, members of the council, Justine Bruno, Management Support Analyst, Town Manager's Office. I'm going to give you a brief update of the lease and agreement between the Town of Gilbert and Operation Welcome Home for Welcome Home Veterans Park. So before I dive into the details of the agreement, I just want to quickly highlight the council action that has happened up until this point. So in June of 2014, this is when the project really is introduced to the council in a study session. Council directs staff to work with Operation Welcome Home to start identifying locations for the site. As we move forward to August of 2014, Operation Welcome Home attends the council retreat. At this time, we start discussing the Gilbert and Elliott site as a location. There are some concerns about this site. Council directs staff and Operation Welcome Home to present to the Redevelopment Commission, obtain their feedback, and then come back to council again. In September of 2014, three sites were presented to council. At that point, the public safety lot, which is the 5 acres of vacant land that is across the street, was identified as the potential site. It is what the concept plan has been built off of as the site for Veterans Park. Staff is also directed to work with Operation Welcome Home, understand the concept and the plan a little further, and develop some potential details around agreements, which is why we're here today. So some major components of the agreement, you have all seen this in your council packet. For those in the audience, it is a 30-year lease term. It can be extended for an additional 4 or 5-year terms. A minor general plan amendment and rezoning are required. Part of the parcel is zoned as residential, so we'll need to convert that to public facilities to make it all the same. The project is broken out into 2 phases. So we have phase one, which most of the site work and infrastructure will be done, grading, the wall, seats, landscaping. That is the bulk of phase one. And then phase two is really the building site, which will be the resource, education center, memorabilia room. 50% of minimum funds are required for phase one prior to Gilbert issuing any building permits. We estimate, or Operation Welcome Home estimates, that the cost for phase one is roughly $2 million. One piece of the property across the street, it contains a retention basin. The size of the retention basin has excess capacity, almost about double than what is needed. So through our conversations with Operation Welcome Home, we've agreed that we'll maintain 76,000 cubic feet, which is necessary to keep public safety draining properly. Gilbert will hold the funds for restrooms that are going to be built in phase two. The purpose of this is, in the event phase two is not built, Gilbert has the monies to build facilities for on-site use, which includes SDF, building permit fees, construction and design costs. Gilbert will also be reviewing and improving all plans for the project, so there won't be a point during this project where we don't know what is being designed and built. Operation Welcome Home will be paying all the permits and SDFs for the site, and we will seek to use reclaimed water for site irrigation. In the event reclaimed water is not available, potable water will be sought instead. So this chart is going to summarize some of Operation Welcome Home's duties and then Gilbert's as well for phase one and phase two. As you can see, most of the check marks are under Operation Welcome Home's column, except for Gilbert that has the check mark in infrastructure. You can see phase one is, like we said, just under $2 million. Gilbert's portion of phase one is the infrastructure, which I'll detail in the following slides, just under $900,000. And then phase two is that building we discussed, that resource center, as well as the permanent restrooms, and that'll total about $1.6 million. The math that you're not seeing on your screen is about $800,000 in administrative costs, so that would be your construction management, more design, additional permits and testing as needed.
This is the conceptual plan that staff has been using to develop our estimates. It may be a little difficult to see. I believe you have it in your packets. The dotted line is most of phase one. As you can see, the dots take up the larger part of the plan. We have the diagonal lines, which are phase two. That's the building pad for the site. And then the cross hatches on either side of the wall represent future memorials. What's not shown on this plan is the bus pullout that would go along Palm Lane. There is a slide at the end of the presentation which you'll be able to see the plan for the bus pullout a little bit better. So Gilbert offsite improvements, this is what we're obligated to as the lease is reading right now, lease and agreement. The construction and installation of the parking lot and bus pullout, it's important to know we are not designing this, but we do have 30-60-90 review of the parking lot and pullout, so we know how it's going to be built for something that we have to install. Water, sewer, and reclaim lines will be extended to the property for the sewer. That also includes the connection to the building. The reclaim water system, there's many items that are under reclaim water. It includes a pump system. It includes acid injection system, a wet well, multiple items that make a reclaim water system functional. And then one off-site directional sign. This item is not shown in the following cost sheet. It's very nominal. We have the materials on hand. It would be at minimal cost to us. So these are putting some dollars to the improvements that you saw on the previous slide. So the parking lot, second highest item here, we have the bus pullout and then the lines for water, sewer, and reclaimed. Again, as I mentioned before, the reclaimed water system, that $385 is all rolled up for the individual items that are needed to support that. And that brings our total to just south of $900,000. I just want to note at this time that cost estimates really cannot be verified until we have construction documents, schematic plans, landscape plans, and so forth. So these numbers are going to fluctuate. It's hopefully not by a lot. We believe the range in the ballpark staff has provided is close, but it's not abnormal for them to change at this phase of the design. What also is not accounted in here is costs for project management, any allowances in construction. So we've built in an additional $300,000 for that PM services as well as some design. So next steps, if the lease and agreement are approved tonight, this is what we can expect. The minor general plan amendment and rezoning will be undertaken within 30 days of council approval. And once that's undertaken, staff will submit to DRB with Operation Welcome Home. So staff will be bringing the application forward, but we'll be doing it with Operation Welcome Home, walk them through that process, and then once DRB approval is obtained, the project will adhere to the schedule you have in your packet. I have one more slide to show you. So as you can see, agreement approved at the end of August, and then we anticipate the amendment and rezoning taking approximately 4 months. That will put us at a January submittal for DRB. And this slide is essentially trying to put some months and years to when you can expect to see the project. So you can see after DRB, the submittal for construction documents and then building permits, it would probably be May 2017 before we're able to actually have a finished product. Phase two is a little too far out to determine at this time. It's depending on the timing of phase one. And I just want to note that these times are optimistic. They do not account for major flaws or setbacks or anything in the process that would hold it up. Before I turn it over to Lisa and Operation Welcome Home, I just wanted to know if there's any questions I can answer for you, staff, or if Town Attorney Mike Hamlin can answer anything for you as well.
Thank you. Please proceed.
Okay. I'm going to welcome Lisa Regler and the Operation Welcome team home to the stage.
Thank you, Mayor and Council, for the opportunity to speak before you this evening. My name is Lisa Regler, and I am the chair of the Arizona Wall Project and president of Operation Welcome Home. I'm also a resident of Gilbert. I have Roger Pollard and Les Pressmick with me as well, who will also be presenting. Our team has been working with town staff on this operating and lease agreement for the past several months, and I want to recognize town staff and the city attorney, who worked very closely with us over the past year and over the past months and year and whom have been indispensable to the success of the project to date. Together, we have negotiated a proposal and agreement that will be a benchmark for other communities in Arizona. As you know, we have been working on the project with the town for the past year, and we've been working on Operation Welcome Home with the town for the past 5 years. I say we have a great team. and we've accomplished a lot for our veterans and for our community. So thank you for your continued partnership. Tonight, we have an opportunity to deepen that partnership and further our service to our veteran community and Arizona residents. We have a lot of people here who have dedicated much time to this partnership, although you might not have met them all. The people wearing black shirts behind me are volunteers. We have 70-plus volunteers, and we continually gain about 1 to 5 new volunteers each week. We also have others with us tonight who help us in other capabilities. All in all, we have hundreds that are helping us in this endeavor. Our volunteers believe in this project, and they believe in our tremendous partnership. These individuals have given over 8,000 hours of their time in the last year, most of it in the past 10 months. That is equivalent of someone working for one solid year, 24 hours per day. Given the national average for what a volunteer's time is worth, that is an estimated to be approximately $150,000 that has been donated in time already. Additionally, there's been many, many hours professionals that have given to the project as well. The people in the audience and others who could not attend this evening so believe in the merits and the meaning of this project that they have and continue to give up their scarce time that could be spent with family, friends, their jobs, and leisure. Each one of them has a different story, the why they are compelled to be part of this team. I'm grateful for each one and every one of them. I want them to be recognized for their efforts. So thank you to all, and please let's give them a round of applause.
Mayor Lewis, Gilbert Town Council, my name is Les Presmick. Gilbert has been our home for 29 years. I am the vice chair of the Arizona Wall Committee. We hear a lot about veterans these days, and rightfully so. Veterans' issues are prominent, compelling, and appropriately in the forefront of our consciousness, requiring our attention and action. That is for good reason. So much is asked of them, and we never seem to be able to return fully in kind. But here in Gilbert, we try. We firmly believe that every person, family, business, civic organization, and our government has a responsibility to our veterans. The town of Gilbert has a good history of commitment to our veterans. Gilbert employs veterans and protects those employees who are called away from their jobs to serve our country overseas, as well as supporting their families. The town has supported Constitution Week, which continues to educate young and old alike about the ideals and values that our military protects and preserves. The town has been a tremendous partner to Operation Welcome Home, opening this facility to military persons, both men and women, returning from a tour of duty, and their families. At the very least, they know their community supports them and is grateful for their service. In fact, Gilbert has received the prestigious Department of Defense Freedom Award in 2011 for employers' support of its veterans. And just recently, the town welcomed a new VA treatment center down on South Val Vista Drive. I think each and every one of you understands how important it is to be on the leading edge of veteran issues. They aren't going away anytime soon, and as a community, the town of Gilbert has always worked to lead rather than follow in this area. Luckily, with this project, you do not have to, and you should not do so alone. Through leveraging strategic partnerships, as you have demonstrated in other areas, Gilbert can provide responsible recognition and services to our veteran community by supporting those already doing it. Tonight is a special opportunity, an opportunity to partner with our organization, who is dedicated to providing this meaningful Welcome Home Veterans Park, a park unlike any other. Typically, cities site, design, fund, and construct their own facilities, memorials, services, and parks to honor local veterans. They give opportunities to the community to participate with selected elements and installations. The municipality normally maintains the facility thereafter. In this instance, Operation Welcome Home is proposing to incur the majority of the upfront costs and then the ongoing maintenance. Our proposal is unlike most and represents a strategic public-private partnership. We propose to design, construct, and maintain the Welcome Home Veterans Park, a park anchored by an 80% scale version of the Vietnam Wall Memorial in Washington, D.C. Operation Welcome Home is willing to build the project and raise the funds of the approximately $3+ million, and that our request from the town is to provide the necessary infrastructure to the site. We will maintain the park to at least the town's standard and even go above. Out of respect to our veterans, the standard we have set is to maintain this park to the same standard as Arlington National Cemetery, and all at our cost. Thus, while other jurisdictions are constructing and funding their veterans parks at their own expense, we believe this public-private partnership is the best approach. It is a win-win for all.
Is that okay?
Mr. Mayor, Council, my name is Roger Pollard. Betsy and I have lived in Gilbert for 28 years. I'm the co-chair of the AZ Wall Project, and I'm on the board of directors for Operation Welcome Home. I'm also a proud Vietnam veteran, and I want to thank everyone in this room who has served in Vietnam or after. Thank you for your service, and I'm so glad you're here tonight. What you have before you tonight is a gift to the town and to the veterans of Arizona and beyond. The Arizona Wall Project will be the glue to those in our community servicing our veterans and their families. This is evidenced by the strong and deep relationships and partnerships we have forged in a short year with organizations, businesses, families all over the state and even beyond, committed to supporting this endeavor and now in the future. We are proud to stand shoulder to shoulder with the Vietnamese community of Arizona, Vietnam Veterans of America, American Legion, Daughters of American Revolution, Vietnam Veterans Memorial Fund, American Traveling Wall Tribute, Veteran of Foreign Wars, American Disabled Veterans, and many political leaders, organizations, and businesses. The value of this project is immeasurable. We are offering the town an opportunity to fulfill a responsibility with physical savviness. The town need only provide infrastructure and improvements. These improvements add to the value of the land that you will retain ownership of in this agreement. Operation Welcome Home is taking on the risk of fundraising for both capital and ongoing costs. Per the agreement, we must show 50% of our financing before construction commences, and we are required to post a performance bond as a backup plan that will complete the project in case of unexpected performance issues. Your yes vote will be a promise to our community that our veterans are a priority to us, and that as a community, we are thoughtfully considering how we are fulfilling our obligations to serve those who are presently serving or who have served in the past. Last year in September, we had been informed that the property next to the Gilbert Police Department would be under consideration as a potential site for this park. Several of us went to the site and we stood on the ground. It was dusk and getting dark and the air was very still. As we stood there, we sensed that there was another presence with us. We individually and collectively felt the spirit of the 58,307 souls that are on the wall. It's difficult to explain the feeling we had, but we felt it in our hearts. We knew then that our purpose must be to bring these souls to Arizona with all the dignity, respect, and honor that they earned and deserve. It was a beautiful moment. Please look around if you can. There are a lot of patriots in this room tonight. People who have dedicated years of service to the preservation of our freedoms as Americans. People who fought wars. People who are still fighting wars. People who promised to each of us that they would be steadfast and resolute in their service to us. you can make a patriotic statement tonight. Let's show our veterans that we will always support them, that we can be the tip of the spear for them, that we have their backs. And we're here to serve as well. God bless you and thank you.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, council members. My name is Kevin Dang. I'm the president of the Vietnamese community. I want to share with all of you that it is a tremendous honor for our community to be part of this project. Mr. Mayor, besides being recognized as a monument honoring the U.S. soldiers who served and sacrificed their lives in the Vietnam War, to us, the Vietnamese Americans who are living in Arizona believe that the Arizona Wall will forever stand as a symbol of appreciation for the American men and women who had made the ultimate sacrifice protecting millions of South Vietnamese civilians from communist invasion. We, the Vietnamese Americans, firmly believe that it is imperative to keep history alive for generations to come. The Arizona Wall is a grand opportunity for us to fulfill our dream and aspiration. The existence of the wall not only enriches our great state of Arizona with valuable history lessons, it also enables young Americans and young Arizonans to have better understanding of the Vietnam War and to appreciate the Vietnamese culture and heritage. On behalf of the Vietnamese community of Arizona, I respectfully ask for your full support of this meaningful and sentimental project. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Vice Mayor Ray, before I turn it back to you to have the speakers come, there is a good feeling of patriotism in the room, and I think it would be fitting, as a couple of you mentioned, to have all of our veterans stand and be recognized. If you could do so, please. Thank you. Vice Mayor Ray, if you could proceed.
Mayor, we will first invite Joan Kruger to speak. Joan, we'll give you 3 minutes, and then for the other seven of you, when Joan is finished, we'll have you take the podium, and you'll have the 10 minutes. The lights on the front will turn on, so you know how much time you have, and when the yellow button or light turns on, that means you have 30 seconds left. And as you'll watch Joan and seen others, if you'll state your name and whether you're a Gilbert resident when you speak, we would appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Good evening. Yes, my name is Joan Kruger, Mayor, Council Members. I am here tonight. I'm a Gilbert resident, but I'm here tonight representing the Gilbert Historical Society. And I want to just say that we have been watching this project now for many years, and I was astounded to hear the number of man hours that have gone into it. It's been very apparent with the success and hard work that you have seen culminate here tonight, and we certainly are humbled by it. One of the things that Lisa mentioned is that I think the word she used was that this was a benchmark for other communities in similar projects, but the Gilbert Historical Society sees it as a benchmark for other things as well, and a real turning point for the town of Gilbert in terms of your commitment to economic tourism. What they're talking about bringing to Gilbert not only is an honor to the men and women who've served, but also certainly sets a great precedent in terms of your commitment to the kind of again, positive impact that nonprofits can make in the town of Gilbert. So we are looking forward, the Gilbert Historical Society. You've been watching us over the last few years, too. We are not nearly as long and as blessed with as many man hours as these people have been able to bring to their project. But you've been with us every step of the way as we are also trying to make a larger impact on the town of Gilbert with some of our projects. And I know that one of the comments that's been made is the great planning that's gone into this project. And I just wanted to remind you that the Gilbert Historical Society has done the same thing. We've engaged several architects over the last few years, and we have several projects that we're ready to go forward with and make a similar presentation like this to you in the months that are ahead of us. So we will look forward to continue to support for large projects that add depth and value to the town of Gilbert, much like this one. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And Vice Mayor, I don't know if I saw the seven get together, so roughly a minute and a half or so, math-wise?
Yeah, about a minute and a half. There's a 10 minutes, and like I said, the light on the podium will turn yellow when there's 30 seconds left. So I don't know if you guys have a specific order you want to go in. I will, is Mr. Milton gonna lead it off for us? So we'll have... We'll have David go first. I'm going to go ahead and give an order here. So if you'll keep this in the back of your mind as you're listening, after David, we'll invite Kevin Dang to come forward, followed by Crystal Reedy, followed by Jack Calixte, Barbara Warren, Skip Erickson, and finally Lou Payne. And again, a total of 10 minutes combined for everybody, please.
Thank you very much. Mr. Mayor, members of the town council, my name is David Milton, and I've been a Gilbert resident for 17 years. For 43 years, I've been in healthcare. The first 20 were in the military, starting as a 19-year-old medic. Healing takes on many ways and cures and fashions by which the healing can happen, and not all healing is through a pill or through surgery or therapy. There's no doubt in my mind that the Welcome Home Veterans Park will offer a site of healing for many, many people. 4 days ago, I attended a funeral of a friend at Arlington National Cemetery in Washington, D.C. Very hallowed ground. There's also no doubt in my mind that the ground that this park will sit on will be Gilbert hallowed ground. Thank you very much.
We invite Kevin Dang, and if you want to go ahead and line up, that would help the process a little bit. Oh, so we'll jump to Crystal Reedy. Following Crystal is Jock and then Barbara.
Hello, I'm Crystal Reedy. I'm a Gilbert resident. I have had the honor of working with this group. And I just ask, I beg you to take this into consideration. This would mean so much, not just to the OIF and the OEF, which is my generation, but all the generations before. The part that is the most exciting to me is my children from 4 years old to 20 years old have grown up in Gilbert under attending Burke Elementary, Gilbert Junior High, and Gilbert High. And the education center that that is gonna be here is going to tell the stories, not just of their parents and their military service, but of their grandparents and their great-grandparents. And I look forward to the day when my great-grandkids will visit this education center and will see and learn about these great men and women who came before us. So thank you.
Good evening. My name is Jacques Calixte, and I have been serving as a Navy spouse for almost 20 years, and as of a month ago, we drove 30 hours round trip to take our son to Colorado Springs to join the Air Force Prep Academy. And sometimes there are things that are not seen when your loved one go to wars, because people see the person coming and going and not knowing what's happening on the inside. It will take me too long to explain what's going on the inside, but one thing I will ask all of you tonight is your unanimous support for this. When I get home tonight, my kids been following the AZ War Project. I would like to say each and every one member sitting on the panel tonight, say, yes, once again, we're gonna put our full weight behind all our veterans, not only the Arizona veterans, not only the Vietnam veterans, the Vietnam, the Afghanistan vet, the Iraqi vet, or vet of any war to come. And I'm asking each and every one of you your support tonight. Thank you.
So after Barbara, we have Skip, and then finally Lou Payne.
I'm Barbara Warren. I'm a resident of Chandler, and I will defer some of my time. I'll be very quick. I would just very much sincerely like to encourage each of you to approve this project. It's an example of what our country needs, I think, what Arizona needs, something with dignity and trust and honor to anyone, much less our veterans who do need it so much. But it's just a new example of giving each other trust and respect. And we're providing a huge area for that. So I just say I encourage it and will defer the rest of my time.
I'm George Erickson on the income tax rolls. Everybody knows me as Skip, but all tax collectors want to find George. I'm also here to prove that not everybody's as bright as all these people you've already heard. They hire normal people as well. What I'm most impressed about, I am an Air Force veteran. I was in Vietnam, 68, 69, and those were very, very divisive. It was a divisive era. And looking at the age, it's one of those, and you can say that about a lot of times. If you were there, you don't need an explanation. If you weren't, no explanation is possible. What I'm most impressed about this is it's not a bunch of old dudes trying to build themselves a park. There's room in this for memorials, remembrances, for past walls, wars, and future wars as well. The Vietnam Wall, the wall we're going to build will be the anchor of it, but there's room for all wars up to including Iraq, Afghanistan, and hopefully not, but probably the next one as well. We lost, and if you don't think we're in any, we lost two Air Force individuals yesterday in Afghanistan. You read all the ink and they're all over, but they're not really over when we have Americans over there dying still. I like the education aspect of the park. It's wonderful. A chance to pass on history. If we don't learn from history, obviously we're doomed to repeat it. I thank you for your time and ask you for your support.
Vice Mayor, I'll just, I was just going to insert that the things you learn in a council meeting, I never knew that Skip was George, but now I know.
We've learned a lot about Skip over the years, but not that. Lou Payne, thank you. So Mayor, that is everyone who has requested to speak. I will also announce that there, in addition to those, there are 58 people who have signed requests saying they do not want to speak, but they are in favor of the project.
Thank you. Thank you all for coming and the wonderful support. And as was mentioned, the hundreds and hundreds of hours of volunteerism, that's what communities are all about. Before we met tonight, and this happens frequently as a council, we have what's called an executive session. In an executive session, it gives us an opportunity with legal counsel present to ask questions of a legal nature or from a contract perspective. And so We're able to do that in a closed session, but at some point, if there's anything to be acted upon, it does come back in front of the public. And so in that executive session, there were several items related to the contract that was published for all of the public to see that have not been disclosed. And so at this time, I would ask our legal counsel if you could, for the public to hear, and it might be Susan who would do this, or Mike, if you have the information, from our executive session, if you could read what the counsel felt would be important to add to the contract. And we understand, and this is for the council to know this, that Susan did have not much time, but a little bit of time to talk to Lisa Rigler, and Lisa also added some verbiage that Susan will describe. And so this time, Susan, if you could update the public and the council as to what happened in the executive session and in conversations you had right before the meeting.
Thank you, Mayor Lewis, members of the council. It's a pleasure to be here and to have worked with the town manager, town attorney, and Justine on this contract, as well as with Lisa Rigler and her team. As you mentioned, the document that was available for public distribution and which you reviewed does have some changes, and I would like to go over those changes, and I believe it's the recommendation of the town attorney that you may approve the, if that's your desire, approve the agreement with direction to staff to insert these revisions and to authorize the mayor to execute it based on that direction. So the first change was that Operation Welcome Home may close the park to the public for its own or its sponsored events a maximum of 20 days per year. And Operation Welcome Home acknowledges that it must comply with Gilbert's Public Assemblies Ordinance when planning and conducting its events. That's a change we would make to the agreement before you. The second one is that when Operation Welcome Home desires to close the park to the public for its own or its sponsored events, Operation Welcome Home will give Gilbert 90 days notice of that event. The third one is that Gilbert may request additional improvements in the park, and Operation Welcome Home will approve such improvements. And this next phrase was requested to be added by Operation Welcome Home. Will approve such improvements unless it determines that they are inconsistent with the purposes of the park. The inserted language being unless it determines, Operation Welcome Home determines that they're inconsistent with the purposes of the park. The third change, a couple of changes are minor. A change to the definition of Gilbert offsite improvements to delete the metering at the property line. And also a provision that provides that would make it clear that in the event Operation Welcome Home is not able to finish the construction of the park, or if it terminates the lease, that Gilbert is it may, but it's not required to continue with that use, and it may, but it's not required to call on the bonds to complete the park. Hopefully, I guess that will not happen. The fifth is an important one, and it changes the some of the requirements with respect to the reclaimed water. It would be to insert a provision something like the following. At its option, Operation Welcome Home may notify Gilbert that it does not want to pay its proportionate share of the underground storage tank for reclaimed water, in which case Operation Welcome Home shall rely solely on the reclaimed water line for the delivery of reclaimed water, and Gilbert shall have no liability whatsoever for any damage to the park caused by its inability to deliver reclaimed water to the park. And the last relates to the shared parking. The agreement you have in front of you does provide that Gilbert may reserve the parking lot that's going to be built for its own use during Gilbert events. But in addition, that when Gilbert gives its notice, and this was requested to be added by Operation Welcome Home, when you do reserve the parking lot for your own events, you will include that in the notice that you have to give when you have your own events. In other words, you give them notice, 90 days notice, that you're going to close the parking lot to their use. And that summarizes the changes. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you. Any questions for Susan? So to the council, in our executive session, we really did not have an opportunity to share feelings as far as how you'd like to proceed. And yet, we did have dialogue that I could tell these were the items of importance to the council to be added to the contract. There were a couple of additions that are now new information for the council, and so I will just ask for help in knowing whether we'd be ready to entertain a motion or if council members wish to make some comments. Councilmember Peterson.
Just had a few questions for staff, if I could ask. Justine? Thank you. Can you tell me a little bit about this project and if it does it help to meet any of the needs that we've identified in any of our master plans or the CIP?
To my understanding, a project of this scope and size and the nature of it is not meeting anything we've outlined in the Parks Master Plan. It's not located in the southern portion of Gilbert, which was an interest by our residents. There will be some restrictions, I imagine, in regards to the use of the park, so it will not be used for recreational sports or anything of that nature. It is limited, so because of how specific it is, it's not meeting any need that we've outlined prior to this time.
Now, can you tell me?
Excuse me, sorry, one second. Yes. I would just say that our needs assessment, it does address, and our needs assessment of veterans' needs and veteran services was one of our core focuses. And so from that perspective, I think that does meet that.
Justine, if there's any questions specifically as to parks, I'd request that our parks director field those questions. Mm-hmm.
Rod's welcome to answer if he feels like.
Yeah.
That'd be great.
Thank you, Mayor Lewis. Councilmember Peterson. The only thing I would add to Justine's comment is that, the parks, there is an open space element that is mentioned in the Parks Master Plan. Excuse me, it doesn't really meet the field and playground needs, those sorts of things, but it does provide extra open space, a flexion area, a place to walk and place to gather. So it is a gathering spot, that sort of thing. So I would say maybe not intentionally does it meet the master plan requirements or recommendations, but it does provide open space for our community.
Does it allow us to reduce anything that we've planned in that plan? So is there anything we can kind of cross off the list or reduce in scope if we build this facility?
Mayor Lewis, Councilmember Peterson, no, it does not.
And then just to address Councilmember Daniels' point, it's a good question. Do we have someone here on the needs assessment who could tell us if the specific needs that were identified would be directly addressed by this facility?
Mayor, Councilmember Peterson, if Leah Hubbard-Reinheimer is in the audience, I would defer to her as the best person on staff to answer that question.
Mayor Lewis, Councilmember Peterson, would you repeat your question, please?
I'm just curious if you can tell us if, based on the planning of this park, and phase two I know is not a requirement put on Operation Welcome Home. It's only phase one that they're required to do for Gilbert, the town of Gilbert taxpayers' participation to kick in. Based on just phase alone, is there anything in the needs assessment that was identified in relation to veterans' needs that would be directly addressed with the building of this facility?
Veterans' population was definitely identified as a population in need. So I think this facility, there's opportunity to address that. In terms of specific outreach efforts and services, I think those would need to be worked out with Operation Welcome Home.
I guess I'm just trying to understand if all we're able to do is proceed with phase one, if we'd be able to address any of those needs with this facility in particular. Is there any way to answer that?
I think with programming, we could. There could be programming on site even without a building there. Certainly with the bathroom there as well, that there would be an opportunity to host things at that event. Obviously, through phase one, it would be a requirement to have those dollars in lieu, or in escrow in order to hold on to. I think definitely there can be programming that goes on there, including things like veterans recognition, an opportunity for other organizations to utilize the space and to teach and to understand veterans' needs and veteran services. So through programming, yes, but just the park in and of itself, unless there's programming involved, we're probably not going to meet any specific need.
Do we have a requirement in the contract for Operation Welcome Home to agree to meet those needs using this facility?
Mayor Lewis, Councilmember Peterson, I would defer to our legal counsel to answer that question.
Mayor Lewis, Councilmember Peterson, there's not a specific provision in the contract to that effect. The contract speaks for itself in terms of what it's intended to do.
Is that something we're interested in exploring? I mean,
Mayor Lewis, Councilmember Peterson, if maybe I could add to that. Until that facility takes its final shape and we understand which agencies will be working out of there, I don't think it would be possible for us to create any kind of list of services that we would seek to have out of that. We'd want to see how it's shaping up, and then I'm certain they would be more than happy to have a conversation with us about what's that right mix of services or what can they do out of that building. But I think it would be premature right now.
I just think if, you know, the point of this park is to serve the veterans, I think we need to try and do that in a very specific and concrete manner, you know. And especially with all the effort that's going into it on the part of Operation Welcome Home and, you know, the taxpayer contribution, I think we need to make the most of that. I would really like to see that incorporated into the agreement in concrete terms. But I throw that out there with a question. I appreciate the answer. I had a few more questions I wanted to ask as well, if I could. Just back to the original needs, and I'll just direct this to Patrick, and I'm just trying to help people understand what my concern is, and I'll make my comments, and I doubt they'll be popular, but I suppose even this crowd can appreciate courage. It'll take some courage on my part to say anything that seems negative at all, but can you tell me, as far as the other needs that we've identified in our CIP that are urgent and are coming up, have we already secured the funding sources we need to meet those needs, Patrick?
The CIP program for this fiscal year is fully funded. Going into future fiscal years, as we discussed at the council retreat a couple weekends ago, staff is recommending that we issue a portion of the 2007 voter authorized bonds for those projects in the future fiscal years. So that is where things currently stand with our CIP program.
So to be clear, we have to get authorization from the voters to borrow money in order to continue to meet needs like streets and the other infrastructure, sewer, water, whatever it may be that people rely on every day.
Sure, Mayor, Councilmember Peterson, the voters already authorized the bonds in 07, but we would seek council approval to move forward with a further issuance of that remaining authorization from 07.
But to be clear, we've only got 1 year left, and then we've got to go to the voters. We just don't have the funds without their approval. So that's coming up very soon.
As it stands right now, there are $70 million in voter-authorized bonds outstanding. Our recommendation, I believe, and don't hold me to this, because as we get closer to time and further define those projects in next year's budgeting process, we're going to request issuing about half of that remaining authorization, and then probably the following year the remaining half.
And I had one last question.
Can I jump in real
sure.
quick? I guess I already did jump in, but it appears that Councilmember Peterson, it appears to me that he's attempting to say that we're using money that were voter-approved bonds, and instead of doing streets and infrastructure, we're doing this instead. If we did not participate in this at all, would we still have to go to bonds for future years?
Mayor, Vice Mayor Ray, yes, we would.
And my understanding is that this close to $1 million is probably less than 5% of what the CIP is. Is that correct?
Yes, that would be correct.
My point still remains that we're going to borrow an extra $1 million at least.
if we use fund balance to pay for this park at this point. And we don't know what the voters will or will not approve. Their appetite for debt has been pretty low over the last few years, and we don't know. And so it's a challenge, it's a concern to think about those needs. One last question, and then we'll let others comment, and I'll comment whenever it's convenient for the discussion. But what is the fair market lease of this land? Justine, I think, may have that, or whoever does.
Yeah, Justine, if you'd like to answer that.
Absolutely. So fair market lease is typically between 5 and 10% of the total assessed value of the property. So in-house, our economic development team, we have not had a full appraisal, so we just want to say that as a disclosure. But we do anticipate that the property is probably in the range of about $1.2 million of what it's worth, the 5 acres of vacant land that is across the street. That is assuming a residential zoning, so it is would be a higher use than a public facility zoning. Based off of that 5 to 10%, we expect that a fair market lease for the 5 acres would be between $60,000 to $120,000 annually. Thank you.
So if we do the math across 30 years, does it sound right if I say it's between $1.8 and $3.6 million across the 30 years? You don't have your calculator?
I don't.
What's your deal?
I'm sorry, I do not have my calculator, but you're usually pretty spot on with your math.
All right, just wanted to clarify. I'll defer to other comments, or I can comment now, Mayor, if that's fine. I mean, I'm already talking, probably digging a hole for myself.
Why don't you finish, and then we can have other comments.
All right. I want to, and I probably should have started with this, I just want to let you know how awesome it is to look at all of you. The respect I feel for you, it's inspiring. It's inspiring to see so many veterans in support of this and to hear the volunteer hours. I thank you for your service. And I want you to know I'm anxious to honor the sacrifices that have been made in defense of freedom. That's very sincere for me. It's also inspiring to see the work that Operation Welcome Home has done over the last few years. It's really quite amazing. I told this to Lisa, and this is more of a personal note, but I am time and again floored by what she and her team are able to accomplish. It's amazing. So I need to compliment everyone who's been involved. Another personal note. My uncle was a Vietnam veteran, and I enjoyed hearing his stories. They were actually quite harrowing at times. He used to fly a helicopter in Vietnam, and we were blessed, blessings from above that he survived that event. But I just want to let you know how much I honor and respect those who served with him. So with all of that, I'm going to quote a founder. This is something I do. But just to show you how patriotic I am, I love this country with every part of my being. Benjamin Franklin said, "A penny saved is a penny earned." And the concern that I have is that we're going to have to go into debt to meet some really urgent and immediate needs here next year. And I'll give you an example of why this matters, especially for veterans' interests. If we build this park for veterans, but we're not able to maintain our streets or build our streets, and a veteran damages car in a pothole, I'm not sure we've done him a service there, okay, him or her. And the point is a lot of people need the streets, veterans included. We have some urgent needs that we have to take care of. And what I'd rather do, I wish we could do. I wish we could get past the bond issuance stage, we get the voters' approval, we can go forward with what we need to do, and then it's clear what funds we really have that we can really spare on things that I think are amazing and wonderful like this project. But when it comes to other more urgent needs, I just have to, if I prioritize, I think there's other things we need to make sure that we cover in order to be truly fair to veterans and to the taxpayers. And so, I just want to point out the total cost. If you add it all up, it doesn't seem like $1 million as much, but when you add up the ongoing maintenance portion that the taxpayers are being asked to pay for, the direct contribution over 30 years is about $1.7 million. And then if you add the fair market lease of the property, and this is an opportunity cost, if we need to help finance some of these projects and it would be helpful to sell the property or release the property or do something, this would help. That ranges from $1.8 to $3.6 million. And finally, because we're going to be borrowing another $1 million for those other needs, that adds a half a million of interest. So all told, we're really looking more at $4 to $5 million over 30 years for this project. Now, for some people, maybe that's nothing for what this does, and it is amazing, but I just would like, to me, it's not a no. To me, it's a question of, can we get to a point where we've figured out our capital improvements? Again, we've got bonds that we've still been using from 9 years ago. So this is an unusual situation. We haven't had an issuance of bonds for almost 10 years. And so, you know, we don't know how that's all going to turn out. And I'd like to see how that does. And I'll end with one final concern. As we heard from the Gilbert Historical Society, there are going to be others watching what we do here tonight. And for me, in my heart, I have a special place for veterans' issues, but, you know, there are a lot of needs that are really important to a lot of people. Everybody's got their cause that's really important to them, and at the end of the day, it's going to be very hard for us to draw the line on other similar partnerships that are going to be turn out to be very expensive for taxpayers, and my goal of keeping taxes down to the rates that they're at now, I don't know is going to be possible even without any optional spending. I don't know. And so if we set a precedent of a lot of optional spending, I cannot believe but tax rates are going to go up. And so that's really my concern. I wish we could continue it longer. I doubt there will be support for that. But I just, again, I want to honor everyone that's here. Thank you for your work. You know, if I get outvoted, I'm still going to be excited about the park. I'm still going to be impressed with what's done, and I'm still going to respect those who serve our country.
Thank you. I think I'll jump in for a couple of minutes. And to Councilmember Peterson and to those who are here in Council Chambers, we just had our annual retreat, and part of our annual Council retreat is we each did a test to describe our personalities and our behavioral style and our communication style. And Councilmember Peterson on our council is the one that spends a tremendous amount of time looking at the details, looking at numbers, a good defender of the taxpayer, and so I appreciate that. I was listening as he started, wondering if we were trying to justify the parks and the services, and I'll just comment, we just had a parks master plan created, and it was never noted that we wanted a veterans park. It was more of a focus on the sports and the fields and so forth we have. We do have some specialty parks in Gilbert. We have a dog park that is well known throughout the valley, and people love to come there and bring their dogs. We also have a riparian park that individuals from around the country will come to watch birds. And then there are other facets of why that park is so popular. But this, it didn't necessarily meet the needs, although, Rod, the open space, I think that was well defined. This is a special park, and it has a special purpose. And again, for those who have organized with a vision for what this park is, it's very inspiring to me. The thought of the needs, I never considered that some of the items identified in the needs assessment would be taking place at this park. Crystal said it so well. This is a future where I want to bring my kids. And there's something very special about that. And parks in general, sometimes it's hard to justify taxpayer dollars with specific numbers that do the return on investment that you'd like to see. But from a community perspective, parks add so much as far as amenities. And so I think this park certainly will fit that category. It's more of the soul of our community that will add tremendous value. But I not noted, and this is where I do want to get to some dollars, that as a priority, I have always said economic development is kind of my barometer as to what will help me make decisions. And it's not intended to say that I'm looking for a payback of individuals that will come to this park and then go shopping, but we fund our town of Gilbert mostly with sales tax dollars and also state income tax. And so I do see this as a park, from an economic development perspective, as a great benefit to Gilbert. My number one purpose, though, is focus on the veterans, and we had a recognition this past year that is one of my favorite things to say about Gilbert, that we were identified as the second best place for veterans to call home in the United States. And for our veterans here, we want to continue to work so it's the number one place for veterans to call home, but we do want it to also be the number one place for veterans and their families to visit, for those not here in Gilbert. So I'm excited about that. And as was mentioned, we're using town land. And our Gilbert Historical Museum, that we just look as one of our great assets, there's land by the museum, and I would welcome, from an economic development perspective, if there are some things that would make sense that we could look at. And I think those are some great future discussions. And if this is a precedence, and there are economic development opportunities that will make sense, I think it's a good precedence. But I to Councilmember Peterson, the justification, the comments about the taxpayer dollars, I appreciate and I thank you for those comments. I also go back to another recognition this year that is one throughout the country that speaks so highly of the efforts of our town staff to make sure that financially we are being good stewards. We received a AAA rating, which is the highest rating you can get for bond ratings for our municipality. I believe that there are 79 other municipalities out of about 20,000 that have the highest rating. And so we do want to watch our debt. We do want to be very careful. But at the same time, we have a great track record of doing so. And so it's not my purpose to say that this is an investment as my top priority. But in so many ways, you will hear in a few minutes my vote to go forward with this project. To me, this is a great investment. But it's also a chance to say to our veterans, thank you. It's a chance to say to our United States community that we want this to be noted as a place to come and visit for you and your families, that it's part of the soul of our community. Other council member comments? Vice Mayor Ray?
I have one question for staff, and I'm not sure if it's for Patrick or Chief Dorn or who it may be for, but that land just south of us that we're talking about was purchased and set aside for future building of town property, whether to expand the court, whether to expand the police station, fire station. Is it fair to say that we don't expect that to be in need even as we reach build out?
Mayor, Council, or Vice Mayor Ray, so the town acquired all this property for the municipal complex quite some time ago. As those buildings and the needs driving those buildings were planned out, the campus has developed to the state it is today. That ground, as it currently states, we have no planned current or future uses for. So it is excess land in the town's inventory right now.
Great. So, Mayor, my comments are, this is an exciting project for a couple of reasons. One, my father was a Vietnam veteran. My grandfather was World War II with Battle of the Bulge. And so it's exciting from that standpoint. And so the family side of me says, we got to build this because I think the veterans will really enjoy it. But far more important than that to me is I think this is a huge benefit for the town of Gilbert. For the visitors who come, I think this will become a great tourist attraction, and I think it'll be probably our biggest tourist attraction, maybe for all the future of Gilbert. That's a huge benefit for the town. We can't calculate exactly the amount of dollars that brings. We can't say that we're going to spend $900,000 in improvements and we're going to get $901,000 back, and so it makes it worth it. It'll be a huge tourist draw for Gilbert. But I think even more important than that, the most important of all, is this is a huge benefit for the residents of Gilbert. I look forward to my family spending time there, my kids, grandkids. I do like how in the rendering they have a school bus on the side. I think at some point we'll probably get tired of all the school buses coming down Civic Center Way because it's going to be a huge attraction. And I think most schools will come here for field trips. And I hope my kids' school gets to come here for a field trip. But I think this is a great project. I appreciate those who have worked so hard, both from Operation Welcome Home and from the town. There are a lot of safeguards that are in the contract for the residents of Gilbert, where if Operation Welcome Home is unable to perform what they expect to perform, and I fully anticipate they will perform all that, but if they can't, there's great safeguards for the residents of Gilbert. So this is not something where we'll have a half-built facility that we can't control, we don't own, and there's no money to facilitate it. And so I appreciate the parties working so hard on this. There is still a tremendous row to hoe going ahead. This is not like tomorrow all of a sudden the park's going to be built and everyone's going to be happy. I can't imagine how much work Operation Welcome Home has left, how far they've come, but how much more they have to go. And so I appreciate everyone's efforts. I think this will be a tremendous, tremendous thing for Gilbert, and I look forward to supporting it.
Thank you. Other council members that wish to make comments? Council Member Cook.
Well, thank you, Mayor. The Cook family has two sides. I would say my American side, my grandfather, who died in the invasion of Sicily, whose middle name, my middle name is after his name. And then on my mother's side, the Japanese side, my mom lost her parents and her sister to the American attack of Okinawa. And my father-in-law, who served in the United States Air Force, served in Vietnam. And I remember as a little boy, when my dad was stationed in Kadena in Okinawa, the many, many military aircraft that was flying from Okinawa to support the efforts in Vietnam. And then most recently, my nephew, or actually my wife's sister's nephew from Africa, who came to the United States to get a high school education, to complete his high school education, enlisted in the United States Army, and did serve a tour in Afghanistan. So we have a long family of history of veterans that have served and given their life, you know, for our country and for our freedom. So I can't even imagine those that have served in this room, you know, your friends that you've fought with and friends that have passed away next to you. I can't even imagine. I just grateful for, again, your service. This project to me, when we talk about a destination that brings, you know, a community together, and we talk about the things that we're doing here in Gilbert for economic development, you know, the trying to make something that's contagious so that we bring families here. This is one of those great projects to me that I believe that will, again, just make our community even better, because it will bring more families here from around the region, from around the state, from around the country. And again, it's a destination, a reminder of the things that we have done, you know, for our history, you know, for America, for the rest of the world to know and understand the importance of sacrifice and freedom. And I cannot express how grateful that I have been for this team to work so hard to really bring that to Gilbert. And I couldn't be more excited for this, Mayor. And again, I'm just really thrilled that I'll be voting yes on this.
Thank you. Councilmember Taylor.
Mayor, thank you. Just a quick question. Susan, if I could just follow up on your comments. I didn't hear explicitly, but the changes that were suggested are acceptable with those, with the feedback they gave?
Yes, sir, they are.
That's good. Okay. Mayor, a couple of thoughts on this. You know, contracts are kind of best guesses for the future. And so we've heard the word partnership on this. And I just, as we proceed here, just want to emphasize that word and start by thanking Lisa and Les and Roger and so many others who have worked really hard in the spirit of partnership on bringing this really amazing vision into Gilbert. Mayor, you've had leadership. Councilmember Daniels has had some leadership and spent significant time on that. And anyways, I've really appreciated that. And I've appreciated each of you that I've talked with, because I've asked some hard questions and dug in on some things. And Lisa's nodding. She knows that I've dug in. You know, we talked a lot about bathrooms. And education is a big deal for me. And I'm looking forward to seeing the buses roll down. And when I see this, yes, it's a recognition for the veterans and the amazing things that they did, but I see some unbelievable value for the future of our children and what they can learn from the history of America that went through this. And I'll stop there, because there's just a lot to be said there, but the educational value of this is going to be tremendous. I'm supportive of this and excited for it. But to just emphasize the word partnership, because as we go forward, there's going to be things that we're going to learn and discover, and we're going to have to work together. And in that spirit is how I'm supporting this, because I think that in the spirit of partnership, as we work with such great individuals with a great vision like this, then we'll truly realize the value that it will bring and can bring to the veterans. And most importantly, the future of our town, which is really what we're here to do, is build a bright future. And with that, I respect the comments of Councilmember Peterson's, because that's what his comments are really in the nature of, is the future, looking forward to our financial future. And I think those are very appropriate. So, Mayor, I'm supportive, you know, in the spirit of partnership and the great vision, and express appreciation for those who are working so hard to bring this in.
Thank you.
Mayor, it's probably no support that I'm very much, no surprise that I'm very much in support of this. I don't often get nervous speaking, but as the microphone went this way, I did get a little bit nervous. You know, we really are a blessed community, and it's one of those things that I'm reminded of on multiple levels, and I can't help but think that where much is given, much is required. And I think when we started Operation Welcome Home in 2010, we certainly never imagined that this is what would come of it. And just this past Saturday, Mayor, and this is anecdotal, but just this past Saturday, we had one of our Gilbert residents return from his tour of duty, where he was in Afghanistan for an entire year. And close to 300 of his neighbors came out on Saturday and lined his street in their neighborhood in Gilbert and waved flags and sang, and we had our Patriot Guard riders there, and we had a lot of our American Legion members there, and we had some of our Operation Welcome Home team. But even above the people that we see at a lot of our events, I saw families and Boy Scouts and Cub Scouts and Girl Scouts, and I saw neighbors and people who loved and cared for this family. And I feel like this is a way we can love and care for our veteran family that we have in this community, because they truly are an integral part of this community. We not only respect what they have done, we respect what they do every day, and we respect what they will continue to do in the future. This has been quite an undertaking as I've watched it unfold. And it just goes to show you what can happen when people who are visionary and people who are committed and people who are passionate, and what they can do with those skills and talents that they have when they exhibit those qualities and then turn them into something meaningful. And so I do applaud each and every one of you for your efforts. And I know that you will continue to work just as hard from today forward, probably harder, if that's possible.
just a tremendous amount of hard work, a tremendous amount of energy, and a tremendous amount of passion, Mayor, for what they do. I feel like this is an opportunity for us to embrace our veteran community. Now, I completely understand the concerns that we might have, but we don't build parks in this community because they will make sense necessarily on paper. We build parks in this community because they make sense to our community members. And we've just heard from a very large community in our town that this makes sense for them. And I think when we launched our Parks Master Plan, if we had been able to have some of these, this only came up a year and a few months ago, if we had included the veteran community in some of that parks discussion, I have no doubt that it would be in our Parks Master Plan. It certainly is a high priority, both from a needs assessment perspective, but also from a community perspective. So, Mayor, it's, again, no surprise, but I am in favor, and I have looked at the numbers. I do understand what the implications are. I do understand what the long-term commitment that this group is making to the town, and I'm excited to see what comes.
Vice Mayor Ray, I would entertain a motion.
Mayor, I move that we approve item 15 with the amendments including the items that were
13.
Excuse me. I got Eddie talking in my ear. Item 13A and 13B, and include in 13A the items that were discussed and presented by Ms. Goodwin to include as part of the final contract.
Thank you. With that motion, is there a second?
Second. Second.
All right. With that motion and second, anything else before we vote from legal counsel?
Mayor, members of the council, no.
Okay. Please vote. That's approved with a 5-1 vote. Thank you. I think we should be standing and clapping for the veterans, but thank you. We move from the consent calendar to the public hearing. I did notice, Vice Mayor Ray, that we have one item. It's 37 to be continued to October 1st, and so looking at legal counsel, we do not need to open the public hearing on 37. We could probably just go ahead and have a vote to move it to October 1st. Is that correct?
Mayor, members of the council, that's correct.
I'll entertain a motion on 37.
I move that we continue item 37 until October 1 of 2015.
Is there a second?
Second.
With that motion and second, please vote. 37 is continued with a 6-0 vote. We have the other items, not counting 37, in addition to 28, 33 through 40, as I said, not counting 37. Vice Mayor Ray, before I open the public hearing on any of these items, do we have some of the items where citizens wish to speak or council members wish to have some time to talk about them individually?
Mayor, we do have a request to speak on item 36. Other than item 36, I have not heard of members wanting to speak on any of those.
Okay, thank you. So I will open the public hearing on agenda item 28, 33 through 35, and 38 through 40, and I will close the public hearing on those agenda items and entertain a motion.
Mayor, I move that we approve items 33, 34, 35, 38, 39, and 40.
And 28?
And 28.
And 28, excuse me.
Okay, thank you. All right, with that motion, is there a second?
Second.
There's a second. Please vote. That's approved with a 6-0 vote. Thank you. I now open the public hearing on agenda item 36, and I understand there will be a short staff update on 36.
Good evening, Mayor and Council Members. Nicole McCarty with the Town Planning Department.
I was just here a month ago, so I condensed my PowerPoint to just give you a very quick overview. The case before you tonight is Copper Landing.
And Nicole, excuse the interruption. I'm hearing from fellow council members, because we did have the presentation last month, it's okay if you give that minute or less summary so the public can hear, and then we'll continue. Please.
Sounds good. I have no problem with that, Mayor. Thank you. The request is for a minor general plan amendment from community commercial to residential 5 to 8 dwelling units per acre, and also rezoning from community commercial to a single family detached with a PAD overlay. The site is located at the southeast corner of McQueen and Guadalupe Road. This is an aerial of the site, just showing kind of the diverse mix of land uses in this site. There is residential, golf course, a lot of employment land. This is in the northwest corridor of our city, of our town, excuse me. This is a development plan proposed. It's 14.3 acres, 90 single family homes. They're laid out in auto cluster style of development. This is how they will be laid out on the site. The deviations they're requesting as part of the PAD are fairly minor. They're asking to go from 10 feet for front yard setback to 5 for rear lots, and from 10 feet for rear yard setback to 5 feet for all lots. Additionally, on one two-story plan, they would be a little bit over their lot coverage at 55%. And they're also going to limit themselves to 30 feet two-story homes instead of the three-story that typically are seen in SFDs. This is just for a sample product. This is a KB Homes site. There's a two-story product. Staff went through a lot of our analysis in detail with you at the last hearing. It is currently zone CC in an area that's very saturated with commercial. It's also, we've looked at it in terms of its potential for an employment use. There is an abundance of vacant employment zoned land in the area, so we don't feel it's got a potential for future employment use. And the proposed development plan that we've worked on for about a year, we feel will help ensure that the project is a good transitional use to the commercial that does remain on the corner. And just to conclude, the Planning Commission voted to recommend approval to the Town Council on July 1st. And again, on July 30th, we presented this case to you. And I know the applicant is here tonight, if you have any questions for him as well.
Thank you. Thanks, Nicole. And David, our applicant, thank you for your patience as we discussed a month ago. There were some new developments that were occurring right at the same date as when we met, and as a council we decided to continue this. We did have some discussion about some of the properties nearby at our annual retreat, and so I might just turn to the council and see if there's some discussion you want to have, some questions. Councilmember Cook.
I would love to have a question for the applicant. The property that's right on the corner, we'll call the northwest corner of that property, does that belong to the same property owner? Because I was kind of curious why not make that all residential versus leaving it commercial. Because I do live literally very near there, and you know, obviously the commercial has struggled through there. I wasn't sure, you know, making that commercial again, you know. Maybe you can comment on that.
Sure, absolutely. Councilmember Cook, and for your record, David Krzyzewski on behalf of Northwest Holdings, which is the current owner of the property here in question. To answer your question, no, my client does not own the 3.5 acre corner. I'm guessing here, but I think it was about 5 or 6 years ago, there was the larger property was subdivided into the 3.5 acre corner than the 12.5 or 13 acre main tract.
Thank you, sir.
Other questions or comments? Councilmember Cook, do you have some? Oh, we had one person to speak.
Yes.
Then let's turn to Vice Mayor Ray and move forward with that.
Mayor, we invite up Kathy Tilke, who wishes to speak against the project. I think you've been here before, Kathy, but if you'll state your name and whether you're a Gilbert resident, we'd appreciate it.
I will. Oops. Thank you so much. Good evening, Mayor and Council. Kathy Tilke. I am a resident of Gilbert and the president of the Gilbert Chamber of Commerce. And we have been before you several times over the years as we look at property that comes before you in what we consider downzoning, when you take a potential employment or commercial property and turn it into residential, you lose that opportunity in those opportunity revenue instead of cost, as Councilman Peterson mentioned earlier. We've evaluated this land, and we spend a lot of time on that. And you know that when we come before you, we've done that. And we've supported some being down zone and others we didn't. In this particular case, as I've mentioned, I know I've talked to you guys several times, but we don't consider this an infill project. We see that as a major arterial corner there in an area that is one of our highest employment areas in the community that is in need of some redevelopment and some new office models over there. We were hoping that we'd have a little more information about what we were going to be able to do in the redevelopment area up there, and that's one of the reasons we asked you to wait just a bit on the decision. But after attending the council retreat, what I found is the information that was provided about the interest in this area actually supports our case to waiting a bit longer to see if there will be interest in employment there on that corner. The fact that the Spectrum project is right down the street a mile, very optimistic about filling that space. The Earnhardt, next to Earnhardt, that property is all right in that corner. This property is strategically located by US 60 and the 101, which is very important to businesses as they grow in our community. And so with that information, we believe we can hold on a little bit longer. And I won't take the time to point to the sites that we've decided to wait on in the past, and we've got some great property there. And one of them is Banner Gateway. We got a lot of requests to go that to residential way back then. They said it would never develop, and look what we have. So I hope that you'll consider that this is an economic opportunity for Gilbert and vote to oppose it this evening. Thank you.
Thank you. Any others who wish to speak?
No, that's okay, it.
Thank you. So did the applicant wish to speak one more time? Okay.
Thank you, Mayor, members of the council. Throughout this, as Nicole mentioned, probably a year-long process now where we've worked very collaboratively with staff, all the city departments to come up with the development plan you see in front of you here. We've sort of weighed and toggled with this issue of, is this area, is this property a viable commercial site? And I think based on all of staff's data, our research, brokers we've talked to, other data, and frankly, even the chamber's own position is that the property itself is probably not commercially viable. And I think what we mean by that is as a retail opportunity. There's a lot of vacant commercial ground in the area. There's a lot of vacant commercial buildings, frankly, directly across the street. There's about 23,000 vacant feet of commercial property there. So if not commercial, I think the question is gets posed is then what? And so we weigh the balance of employment or office or business park versus a residential need. And as of all the conversations I've had on this topic in months and months now, that this balancing test, this weighing of the scales is probably the most appropriate. And I think what you're looking at here is the scales are somewhat tipped. What we have here in this area of town is a significant amount of both vacant land and vacant industrial buildings, and a significant amount of vacant commercial land and vacant commercial buildings. What you don't have here in town, as staff pointed out in the report, is a good population density. And the lack of population density in here, and by population density, I'm specifically referring to residential, it has impacted the commercial, and I think that's evidenced by the closed commercial in the area, or the turnover rates in commercial in the area. And so we have this tipping of the scales. And I think by taking this property, putting it into a productive use as a good residential development, a 90-lot residential development, will have some energizing effect in the community. The property has sat vacant, as you know, for many, many years. And again, if we're all in agreement, and I think we are from all the data, commercial development's probably not viable here. And does employment work? Does an employment use, whether that be a business park or commercial office, work in direct proximity to a church, direct proximity to single family residential? I think in the context of land use planning, the answer to that's probably not. And so as we look at this, and can we tip these scales by bringing some new vibrant residential development into this area, some new people, some more energy. You know, we all know people shop where they live, and bringing new bodies in here will support the struggling commercial in this area. So I think for all these reasons, again, what we're proposing tonight makes good land use planning sense. And that's really what we're here asking for, is a land use decision of, does a residential, new residential development on this property make sense in the context of what has historically developed here, which has been largely residential. And again, we bring this forward to you, as staff noted, with strong support from your Planning Commission, strong support from your staff, the support of the Gilbert Public Schools, and frankly, no community opposition. And so again, with that, and while I respect Ms. Tilkey's position in terms of this could be an employment use in the future, I think the scales here being tipped heavily this way, and the opportunity now to balance and bring this area back into balance a little bit, is before you tonight. So I would appreciate your support on the matter. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Cook, you're the one that lives closest. So council with us.
Well, I shared a lot at the last meeting. You know, we could have, you know, voted on this and made it go through. But again, you know, being a resident there and watching the retail commercial, it's been painful. And in fact, I think most of my neighbors, when we lost the Walgreens that we've used for the longest time, it was like, you know, a huge, you know, loss for all of us, and chatting with the manager. And, you know, we are in a down economy, and I fully appreciate and understand, you know, Walgreens' corporate position of managing, you know, their operations. But they came down to, we just don't have enough foot traffic there. And so, again, we've seen a lot of the retail, you know, around there. The businesses have tried to survive and so forth. Very grateful for the Dutch Brothers that's there, because it's revitalized the southwest corner, and there's businesses now that are flourishing there as well. There's a Montessori school that's there on the corner, and that's really good. So, you know, for me, it's always been very difficult for me to want to flip commercial residential. I'm probably one of the strongest advocates, and I know we do these case by case. I know that we did the one down on the southeast corner of McQueen and Warner, right behind the car wash. I was not in support of that. I think Councilmember Daniels and I felt that if we put residential there, the other side of the intersection was Chandler, and they're going to put, you know, retail there. But, you know, we as a team, you know, we voted in support of that. You know, recently we supported the flipping of the corner on the northeast corner of Elliott and McQueen to residential. And I believe that presentation of the SunTech project, which is phenomenal, I you know, we just saw a little bit more information about, you know, how many potential new families that, you know, it would draw because of the employment and new employees there. You know, those folks could probably easily potentially live in this property and the other properties that I mentioned. So it's always hard for me to switch or flip from commercial to residential, but I think in this case, this makes sense. So I'm in support of this particular change.
Councilmember Peterson.
Mayor, I very much respect those who are concerned about, you know, letting too much commercial turn residential, and I understand that. I think we all want to see as much commercial property, specifically business, and retail too. We want to see as much of that in town as we can get. I think it's just hard. None of us have a crystal ball. Who knows what could happen in this property, you know, 20 years in the future? What we do know is that it's sat here about that long vacant, and we've watched other, you know, commercial properties in the area become abandoned. It's just, yeah, there's a lot of what ifs, but I think at the end of the day, I continue to believe that the market knows how to find that right balance, because the reality is you need residential to help support the commercial, and you need vice versa as well. And I just think the market does a little better job of finding that right mixture than we can from a central body. We just don't know as much of the dynamics as much as the dynamics of the market will tell us. And so with that, Mayor, I'm supportive of it, but certainly respect those who have concerns about these kinds of changes.
Vice Mayor Ray.
So I think Councilmember Peterson and Councilmember Cook have made valid points. I really appreciate the developer, the client here, David and James Canlin, Warden Nichols. They've been a tremendous help to me as they've explained the process, and they've gone out of their way with time and energy and effort in answering questions for me, and I appreciate it. I do feel different than Councilmembers Cook and Peterson, and that when I look back at this in 20 or 30 years, and we're all long gone, and I am very hesitant to convert things from commercial, from retail to residential. I agree that this is very unlikely to ever develop as a retail center, but we talk about housetops and roofs and those things, and we keep talking about this development of 800,000 square feet that's a mile south. And it was ironic because when I asked them in the meeting, the retreat, why there and what about residential, their first response was, we love this spot because there's so much residential and there's so many rooftops, we have a great employment base, and that's why we're choosing to build this here. And so I look at this and think additional rooftops, obviously the school district likes that, I understand it. I'm just not sure it's best for the long term of Gilbert. It has sat empty for a long time, and I have no buyer in mind or no, I don't have anyone to come lease it from them. But I also looked at it's been owned by a church for the last 10 to 15 years who did not market it. And so if someone were to actually market this to a commercial tenant, there may be a different scenario. So again, I don't have a crystal ball that says anything's gonna happen today or tomorrow, but looking years and years ahead, I think that it's a little bit early to convert this with the additional square footage that's finally starting to happen in that Northwest corridor with job growth. And so this is a tough one for me, but I think that as a council and as a town, we'd be better off not approving this change and waiting and seeing what happens.
Councilmember Taylor.
Mayor, thank you. For me, you know, we start with property rights, and there's a really high bar that has to be cleared to tell someone they can't do what they want with their property. I mean, that's a tough thing to do. And so when I sat down, I've talked to Kathy a couple of times, and we've had some good discussions on this and some homework on that. And definitely she's doing her job representing the business community, and appreciate some of the input. Some additional homework maybe I would just share with the council, because I drive this on a regular basis, and going down this, there's three corners of commercial already. And one of the learnings that Dan helped me with is that Chandler did a four-corner study recently. Maybe you've heard about it. He kind of asked the question, you know, how much should a town reasonably plan commercial on four corners? Is all four reasonable? And obviously, there's lots of assumptions and variables in the study, but the bottom line is saving four corners on a consistent basis is over-programming it, and you're setting up and cannibalizing some of the other corners by doing that. And that's one of the factors here that I think we need to be aware of, because the other three corners are already in as commercial. And then if you look at the vacancy rates in the area, you have about 16% vacancy rate in a 3-mile radius of this intersection. The East Valley average is about 10.8%. So you have, you know, almost 5% more vacancy in this space. You go down and you see the Leroy Breinholt, you know, leasing signs over and over and over and over. It almost looks like an Eddie Cook campaign, you know, is running here with all these signs going down. So maybe you got that from you, Councilmember Cook. But I mean, there's just a lot of commercial in the area. And so for me, I don't know that it's met the threshold. Private property rights are sacred, and if we're not protecting those and letting people do, you know, within the reasonable constraints of planning and that responsibility that we have, and that's important. So I'm supportive of the project with just some of those learnings, and share that with you.
Councilmember Daniels.
Thanks, Mayor.
Again, zoning changes are some of the hardest decisions that we make because we are trying to balance both the property rights and also the voters' will when they approve the general plan, and just all of those different dynamics. I think more than anything, this is a timing issue. I think we're seeing a revival in this northwest corridor of town, and it gets us excited as a council to see what the potential of this area is. One thing that I hear over and over again from our residents is a concern about some of the density of some of our housing projects, and that does give me some great concern when I see this project. We changed the parking requirements a few years ago, maybe just a little over a year ago now, and I did see that they've met and slightly exceeded those numbers, but I don't know that in the long term we're really satisfying that requirement, even with the new code. So it's sort of a wait and see game for us. As we've identified some of these core employment areas, I think it, without having marketed this property, it is really premature for us to move forward with a zoning change. And for that reason, I'm not supportive of it. That doesn't mean I'm not supportive of it forever. It just really is a timing issue. And I'd love to see some more movement and action in this area, whether it turns to be employment or whether it ends up being retail. I cannot predict that, but it has been community commercial for quite some time. We're still leaving a commercial corner. So as far as a four corner study, there still is that 3.5 acres, even with this piece that would be considered commercial, and really is only either a fast food spot or a gas station. I mean, really, that's sort of the only viable that I see on that small 3.5 acres. So again, I think we're a little premature, Mayor. Patience, aggressive patience is one of our key themes that we've had in this town, and I think we need to continue to be aggressively patient with maintaining some of that commercial space. So for that reason, I'm a no.
So thank you for making me the swing vote on this one. I did have a chance to go by the property today, and I think I put my Steven Spielberg hands out, and I was looking at the 10-story buildings, and and then I went down, Councilmember Cook, to the northeast corner of McQueen and Elliott, and kind of wish I had that vote back as I was seeing the.
Well, did you look at the Walgreen that's empty when you looked at, and you looked to your, opposite side, and you said, that's a loss to those neighbors. I know they're very sad.
Lobbying goes on right up. It's an area, and I've talked to school leaders. They're definitely in support of it and do appreciate feedback from the chamber, which has a great impact on me. Some of the statistics that Councilmember Taylor had mentioned, I think talking to the planning department and economic development team members influenced me where they are supportive. To Council Vice Mayor Ray, the long term and the aggressive patience, I think, have a lot of merit, but dartboard, I'm ready to move forward in support of it. So we'll break the tie, and I close the public hearing on agenda item 36, and we'll entertain a motion.
Mayor, I'd like to move that we approve agenda item 36.
Second. With that second, a motion second, please vote. All right, that's approved with the 4-2 vote. Thank you. I believe we move to administrative items. Agenda item 41, is there any discussion information that needs to come to the council, or as a council, are we ready to proceed with that item?
Mayor, it's not budgeted, but I'm not sure we have much of a choice. Just saying.
Yeah. Okay. Would you like to make a motion?
What's that? Unless we don't want to settle our claims, Mayor. Are you saying we don't settle our claims?
Mayor, I move that we approve item 41.
Second. Thank you. Okay, with that motion, second, please vote. We do take care of our claims. We've covered 42, item 43, board commission and committee reports, please. Councilmember Peterson.
Sorry, I was all excited to announce a little bit more about One Nation Under God. So just a reminder, September 17th, 7 p.m., Mission Community Church, our lineup of speakers, and of course it's a concert, so we're going to have a lot of music. It's going to be wonderful. We have a professional producer putting the show together. It's going to be fantastic. We have Father Will Schmidt of St. Mary Magdalene. We are very excited to have him. We have Pastor Tim Thompson of Fountain of Life Fellowship. And we have veteran Robin O'Bannon. She is a fantastic speaker. So we are very excited with that lineup. And again, just invite everyone out. It's going to be a fantastic. And by the way, Maren, not a single tax dollar. Just saying. It's awesome.
Well, and thanks, as you said, to the Mission Community Church for offering and the Constitution Week group that's been doing a lot of fundraising. Thank you. Vice Mayor Ray or Councilmember Cook, any updates on boards commissions? Well, then let me just add, and we did it at the start of the meeting too, Councilmember Peterson, that the One Nation Under God is on Thursday the 17th, which is the actual date of the signing of the Constitution in 1787. And 2 days later will be the Constitution Fair, one of the great family events in our community that will be on Saturday night here at Town Hall from 6 to 9 p.m. Councilmember Taylor, anything?
Well, let's not forget the Scout Night.
That's Scout Night, please.
The 16th and the 23rd. Mayor, do you know that we set a record last year with over 2,000 Scouts coming through the Merit Badge Clinic? And appreciation for your leadership on Constitution Week and those here on the dais that help teach. And if they're still looking for a couple more teachers, if anybody hasn't been invited, let me know and I'll get you connected.
It sounded like 5,000 kids when they were leaving, just so you know.
Isn't it? It's really fun. It's fun to be there. It's probably one of the biggest scouting events in Arizona every year, right here in Gilbert.
Councilmember Daniels. Okay. Future meetings, communication from town manager.
Thank you, Mayor, members of the council. I wanted to recognize some staff tonight for some projects, starting with the staff that was involved with the Operation Welcome Home Park that we just heard this evening. I want to thank Justine Bruno, who became our point person from the town's perspective to help finalize those negotiations and bring that agreement to you to a conclusion today. She took over from one of our former assistant to the town managers, Andy Welsh, who took over from another former assistant to the town manager, Gabe England. So Justine really stepped in at the last minute and helped keep that ball moving forward and help gather the data and the information we needed so that you could make an informed decision tonight. So we certainly appreciate her for that work, as well as Susan Goodwin, who was the lead special counsel to help negotiate that development agreement with the folks from Operation Welcome Home. And then Håkan Johansson, who did a lot of work and helped us understand the reclaimed water needs, which became a rather large issue that we needed to work through. So there was many other staff behind that, but I wanted to recognize some of the key players for the great work they did on that. Also with the census, you saw our official kickoff for the marketing efforts for that with the PSA tonight. It's been a great team of people behind that. If I could just recognize some of the key people, beginning with very early on in this process, Leah Hubbard-Reinheimer, in her old role as our Intergovernmental Affairs Director, helped bring this to our attention. Nicole Lance, one of our former assistant to the town managers, picked the ball up and ran with it from there in formally engaging the Census Bureau and helping us understand what the process entailed and getting us prepared for that. And then since that time, it's been turned over to, again, Justine Bruno, who works in the manager's office, who has been helping to coordinate the responsibilities with the Census Bureau in what they'll need to become operational here on the ground. Dana Birchman and her very talented digital government team for that PSA and the marketing efforts they've put together to help educate and inform our community raise the awareness levels of the importance of the census to our community, and now their efforts are being emulated and copied by other census communities around this region. And then Carrie Bosley and her team down in HR, I just got word today that we have received 1,300 applications for the special census workers. So that is a great turnout, and we are on track and on target for an October 1st start date.
Did you apply?
I did. I didn't make the cut. So there'll be some follow-up on that. But I want to thank all of them. That has been an incredible team effort to get us where we are today. So with that, Mayor, I will end it with the knowledge that the Cardinals are about to complete their sweep of the Diamondbacks at Chase Field.
We better not cheer that on. I did the public service announcement that we saw at the first part of the meeting. I was a little bit worried that dart that Councilmember Daniels threw at you, did it hurt? Are you okay?
You know what was disappointing is that after the third take, they said we've got it, and she just kept going. 20 takes later, I don't know if she's a perfectionist or if there was something else that I should read in there.
Mayor, I hit him multiple times, and I'm left-handed, but I was using my right arm for the camera. I just want people to know that.
Oh. Thank you. Report from council members on other items. The two items that I will close with, yesterday, the Arizona Nursing Education Committee approved for St. Xavier University to open their School of Nursing. There is one more step on September 18th that will go to the full nursing board, but the Education Committee said that at this point it should move forward, and so we're very excited for St. Xavier University for that. And
Mayor, would you like to mention something about their provost policy?
Please. I'll let our town manager do that.
We received very sad news on Monday of this week that St. Xavier University's provost, Paul DeVito, passed away on Sunday unexpectedly. He was a huge part of helping to make this campus happen in Gilbert, Arizona. He was just a pleasure to work with, a great man, a great educational leader for them. I know that they had plans and potential that he was going to replace Chris Wiseman, the current president, when she retired. So we were all just devastated by that news and send our deepest condolences to his family.
I know that many of our town leaders and town staff got to know Paul quite well. He was the one who emceed the dedication just a few weeks ago. So that is a very sad thing. And as a community, we are working to make sure that the family knows of our love for Paul. Thank you. I also this morning had a chance to attend, from an innovation standpoint, something that just on the cool scale is a 10 plus. SRP has at one of our Gilbert facilities opened up a data center, and the significance, without getting into a lot of details, is that the data center is inside where they have all of their power supply. And so what it does, it's a source of power that saves a lot of money. It avoids waste. And the quote that they gave, it was, we're taking the data center to the grid and not the grid to the data center. And there's a lot to that, but from an innovation standpoint, it's another great asset in Gilbert, and we thank SRP for their leadership, vision, and putting it right here in Gilbert, right by your house. Thank you for the participation tonight. And on that note, I'll use the gavel, and we will officially call the meeting adjourned.